my old windows. We will not be needing them because we're going to be using the one from National Parts Depot.
This week on Auto Resto Mod, Jeff and Cam selflessly attack the door glass on our 66 Punisher for install tips and tricks.
What it rolls up nice now, though.
National Parts Depot offers quality restoration parts for Mustang, Cougar, Camaro, Firebird, Chevelle, GTO, Chevy and Ford trucks, Bronco and Thunderbird. For quality parts in stock and delivered fast from our four warehouses nationwide, nobody beats NPD's speed and service. For your free catalog, go online or call toll free. NPD, make your dream happen.
What's wrong here? Well, okay, you were gone.
Yeah, I was.
We had some other personal issues come up this week. Unable to get the door on. Needed your help. You weren't here.
Gotcha. Yeah, it's my fault.
It's always your fault. Anyway, really cool stuff.
Yes. My old windows.
We will not be needing them because we're going to be using the one from National Parts Depot. There's a complete replacement. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in a minute.
All right.
But this is why we're replacing it.
It's slap wore out.
Yeah, the bar on it's actually in pretty good shape, but the rest of it is pretty
toasty. Weather strips, crinkly.
Yes.
Chrome's pitted on the inside and the outside.
And it's a replacement glass anyway.
Yeah,
it's not like you're trying to maintain your Ford glass on your pitted original bin window.
It's Camcorse. Let's replace this one.
Just paint it black.
Stealth windows.
Yes. So what we're going to do is we're going to replace this with this on this. This week.
And then after this, we're going to take it all back out and then put it on the new door when we put the door on. Wait, no. I'm going to do that.
Yes.
Yeah.
The cool thing is we're also going to be putting Beltline weather strips on this door.
Awesome.
We're going to talk about that kind of thing.
So I'm going to have to replace them because they're going to get trashed.
They're going to get trashed when you take them out.
Sweet.
Love you. Bye.
I love this plan.
All right. So vent window.
Yep.
Really nice.
Yes, beautiful.
I will say this. Remember we were talking about, I said there was something about this that I found extremely interesting.
Mm-hmm.
That is the fact that if you buy the vent window and all the stuff to put it on, even if you keep your division bar, your glass, you're only about $50 cheaper than buying the entire piece.
That's completely worth it in my opinion.
We're going to do an assembly on one of these. We're going to put one of these together. NPD is going to send us one. We're going to do the whole thing on it. And I'll say this. I've done enough of these.
It's worth $50 in labor to buy
it. Yes. I would work an extra couple of hours at work if I were you to get the one that's complete. It's a really nice piece. It's the same stuff that you get when you get the disassembled one. But everything's here and it's all done. It's all brand new. All the attaching hardware, brand new.
All the chrome is
fresh. All the chrome is beautiful and fresh. I mean, it's got brand new division bar on it with the weather strip already in it. Brand new vent window handle. Brand new glass. All the what? And the thing is when I did the split out on it, because you have to buy a special tool to do the rivets for this piece in here, the tool is like $100.
So
you do just one of these by itself, and I broke out the pricing. When I did that, that was just for one side.
Mm-hmm.
You're still at the same, almost the same cost. So I'm of a mind that this is the way to go.
Yeah.
What I'm going to do now is I'm going to pull this out of the way and we're going to talk about what else we've got here on the table. I like this piece. I'll see how it installs in a little bit when we go onto that front. But for right now, I'm going to move this out of the way and we're going to talk about this stuff and how we're going to do it.
Right.
Okay, so your window regulator. Now I know that you thought, I want to replace this.
Yes. Old and...
We're not replacing
used.
It. No, we're not replacing it. And it's the reason is this. Most of the time on the Mustang especially, the passenger glass is in decent shape.
Yeah, because it's never used.
It's never really used that much. It's not rolled up and down nearly as much as the driver's glass.
Yeah.
So we're keeping this piece, but we are going to lube it up. Now, a lot of guys will use lithium.
Lithium hardens.
A lot.
Yes.
It becomes rock-like.
Yeah.
And I don't like rock-like. So what I found was a lot of guys in the import groups are going to super lube.
Unsurprising.
United Colors on it. Maybe this is from the European theater because that was the ribbon that they gave out after World War II. I don't know. In any case, it's super lube. This stuff won't harden. It's a silicone. Mm-hmm. It'll stay nice forever. The only disadvantage is it's not, I didn't find one. I know they have a spray model, mm-hmm. but it was not available when I ordered this.
Yeah, all
you can
get,
you can get it in a spray, but they didn't have it available. So we're using this. And then the other product we're gonna be using for some of the light greasing on this is Gibbs oil. Now, Gibbs oil is one of our favorite products. Yes. We use it around here on a ton of stuff. Works great.
Wizard in a can.
I like that.
Yeah, it's my nickname for it at work.
Whatever you do, don't use WD-40 to do any kind of lubrication work. Mm-mm. It is not for that. This is a lubricant. WD-40 is not. So now we're going to pull that out of the way and talk about our final little bit of stuff. And that is the lock knobs and grommets. Now, I know on your special car, that's not really an issue right now.
Yeah, mostly because that is probably going to get broken when I put my arm out the window.
Well, I like the ones you had on there. I threw them away already, but they were really different.
Yeah. I think one didn't even have one.
No, it didn't. Yeah. The passenger side had one, but it's gone now.
Yeah.
Finally, we got all of these in. Yeah.
I can finally roll my windows
up. You can roll your windows. Well, not now because
there's
no windows in there. But we got these and also this to replace the one that I tried to cut off with the Sawzall.
Yeah. Thank you.
So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to push you out of the way. We're going to pull this back in, and I'm going to show the lubrication points and where you want to put the super lube on here in order to get this thing where it's rolling beautifully.
I'll get these out of the way so we don't lose them.
If you put them up in a special place, we'll never
find them. We're going to lose them anyway because I'll forget where I put them.
All right, so I'm going to talk about a window regulator that's an existing one that you already have on the car. When you get them in, you still want to make lubrication stuff happen to them. But what I want to talk about is those lubrication points that you need to take care of. Now, one of the first things you're going to want to do is these points here, which are where your rollers go, and you want to grab a Scotch-Brite and just clean them up a little bit with the Scotch-Brite, get any rust that may be on there off. Sometimes these things have sat down the bottom of a window run for a little while, and these things can be pretty nasty. This one's not too bad, and I'll go in later, when I go to put the rollers on here and put some of the super lube on all three of these points. You have two here and one here. Another point of lubrication is this pin right here. Not really a lot you can do with that, but what I do is I'll take this, if I don't have the spray bottle of the super lube, and I'll try to push some lubrication up in there around the outside perimeter a little bit and do a bit of a spin to it and just move it back and forth to get some of that down up in there. I also have already gone in and put a little bit of Gibbs oil into that area as well. You can go in and kind of push that up in there with your finger too and get it up inside of the crack. Just keep moving it back and forth, and you can see it actually starting to pull some of the rust out from inside of that area. That's letting you know that the lubrication is getting up inside of the lube point. Now, next place that you'll go to is here. There really isn't a good way to get up in there too much, but this thing nicely will spin all the way around. So what I'll do is the same thing. I'll take the super lube, put it up underneath that edge there a little bit, and I'll push that in there. This thing isn't super mobile, but if you get it lubricated well enough, you can see that there's a relief around this area here, and that's what runs on that other metal. Now, what I'll also do at that point is I'll go in and I'll put a little bit of Gibbs oil on the actual pin itself. This is going to be kind of sloppy for a little bit. You'll want to clean it up before you put everything back in the car so it's not a handful, it's greasy. And pull it off. And you'll need to do the same thing with this. Take this, set it aside so you don't lose it. Take this apart, and then you can also use your Scotch-Brite on here, lubricate the mating surfaces, and also use the Scotch-Brite to clean that up. I'll put that aside. I'll do that in just a second. Lubrication points on here. You have another pin. You can take Gibbs oil and shoot a little bit down inside the pin to help with lubrication there. But you can also, though, roll this all the way up to here. Grab your super lube. Shoot a little bit of it down in there. A little bit of it right there. Okay, we got a good lubrication now on that. Now, the other thing that you're going to be dealing with is your gear. Sun gear is what it's called. Your Sun Gear has a lubrication point. You can see where it's been dragging through the old lithium grease. Now this is the lithium. I'm gonna have to clean this off. I'm gonna do that off camera, but you can see this is the lithium grease. And it's basically almost like dirt now. It's not a good clean grease. So we're gonna use our synthetic and get in there. Another lubrication point, the suspend point is right here. You can shoot a little bit of the Gibbs oil down in there. And what you're doing basically is you're wanting to give this every good chance it can get for operating correctly in the car. Another lubrication point is this is your center pin for the crank itself. What you can do is you can take and squirt some of this down inside. Let that sit for a little bit and that'll actually run down to the pin point on the back side of it. I'm gonna get this thing lubricated up, get it ready to go back in the car. We're gonna move on from here.
All right, now I'm gonna install the new division bar and front window. We have put masking tape on the chrome just to protect it because, as we've said, we're gonna be installing and removing this several times. That's just protect the chrome. So first thing you're gonna do is turn it about 45 degrees clockwise to allow that 90 degree bracket to drop down. Slide it in nice and careful. And once you get to this point, what I like to do is hold it, take your first adjustment stud, go through the second hole down on the front of the door, put it into the bracket. Once you have the stud threaded in, you're gonna wanna run it all the way down until the washer touches the vent window assembly. All right, that one's touching. Now take your second one. Now if you're doing this with the front of the door on, this would be pressed up against the outside skin. You're gonna reach your arm through, thread it into the bottom on that 90 degree bracket, and spin that one all the way down as well. Right, now that you have that, rock the back down, and then slide it forward. Making sure that both of your adjustment studs are in their respective bolt holes. Then you're gonna thread them out a little bit until the washer touches. Now take your two nuts. Now we haven't cleaned these because this is not the final installation on this door. We're gonna be, as we said, taking it out and then we're gonna clean them and paint them and make them look all pretty. Thread your nuts onto the adjustment studs. Now these are specific. These have a captive washer that spins and is very wide, so it holds pressure across a wider area. And then you have two other specialty fasteners as well. You have a short and a long. The long will go in the back, which is kind of hidden. You have to look down a little bit. It's right beneath the vent window, almost in line with the handle. Then your short one goes in the top front hole. Again, you might have to move the window around to get the bolt starting the threads. I'm just going to run these down but leave them loose for adjustment later. All right, now after the front vent window is in, next up is the rear track. When you get a new one, it's going to ship with the bracket on it to stop the window from coming out. You're going to have to take that off to install. So what you're going to do is, if you don't have a gaping hole, you're going to slide it on the back of the door, roll it into position, then come up on the back side, start two serrated washer bolt, start two of your serrated washer bolts in the top, and then the bottom one is a sliding nutsert. So you're gonna have to find the nutsert. You're just gonna have to fiddle around a little bit to find the threads of the nutsert. And once you have that threaded in, leave that loose as well. I'm going to install the inner track. Goes on the door like that. Two nuts on the back side. You can go ahead and tighten these because there's no adjustment on this rail. Next up is the glass.
All right, Cam has got the rear glass run in. He's got the front division bar and all in. All I'm doing right now is finalizing the cleanup on the track here. Normally I would take this track off of the glass, put it in the bead blast cabinet, and do a real good cleanup and repaint of it to keep it nice forever and ever. We will do that, not right now. What I usually will use is like a Rust-Oleum Silver on here. It works really well. It's a rust preventative paint. Should be good to go in that instance. What I use when I'm not going in and bead blasting, and what I will want to do is clean this up before I bead blast the whole thing, is I'll take some coarse steel wool, run it down inside the track, and bear down on the bottom and on the top so that the area where the roller runs through there is nice and clean and free of any schmutz, because that schmutz will stop or slow down the roller from going through its track the way it should. This is pretty much ready to go, so I'm gonna hand this thing off to Cam. Okay, you're off to Cam. All right, buddy, here you go.
Yay.
Pre-lube for your protection.
And pleasure. Now, when you're dropping this in, you're gonna wanna roll the front down first. There you go. I roll it in and then pull it towards you. When you start rolling it down, make sure that you're in the front track. And ease it down till the very bottom. There we go. Next up is the window regulator. All right, now that we're going to do the regulator, you could use a vice grip to hold the window up, but we have brand new tracks, and that feels kind of dirty. So we use the next best thing, which is Jeff.
Is it because I'm... Never mind, I don't want to know.
Yeah, just go with that. All right, so I'm going to slide the regulator in. And work it down the door. It's kind of tedious because all of this stuff moves and loves to pinch your fingers.
Also, you want to worry about the inside of the doors as well, because you can ding the door putting the regulator in the car. Now, obviously, we could do this from the backside. It'd be a lot easier, but
it's so much easier.
You're not going to have that option, I hope.
If you do, use it while it lasts.
You got to get on the other side of the division board.
Yeah, no, I got to pull it back first.
Three foremen, one guy working.
Yep, it's a government job.
Government job. I would help you, but then that would be cheating.
Now I can hold this one-handed, line up my bolt holes.
You're just doing this because you like seeing me all stand here in this tank.
And I have my arm snaked through here.
Have I got a book I can read? All right, now when you're setting this up, you want the sun gear to be relatively in that position so that you can put the mount point for the actuator arm in. So probably 2 to 3 inches away from this side of the sun gear. You got two more bolts at the back. You'll want to go ahead and install all four of those and get those in for final. It'd be a lot easier if you had my size arms than his size arms going through those holes. Another good little tip that you can use is the pinch welds that you can buy from National Parts Depot. You can buy an extra bit of pinch weld, put those around the openings. That'll keep you from cutting your arms up a little bit. I forgot to tell Cam about that.
Thank you.
I learn sometimes. I had to do it this way for a long time. I'll see why you shouldn't, you know, continue learning.
Are you supposed to pass on knowledge?
I'm old, I forgot.
All right, now slide the windows down, put our rollers in.
There we go.
All right, there's good. Too much.
Sorry.
Gorilla hands can't fit down there.
Big hands.
What that means.
You know they say about guys with big hands, right?
Yep. I gotta find big gloves.
Okay, glass needs to come down too, or the roller needs to come up.
Alrighty, she is in.
All right. All right, now before you go in and put the Beltline weather strips in, you want to look at the door and make sure that everything along this line is flat. We've got a little bit of a protrusion along here. This piece right here, the base needs to be bent in just a little bit along here so that it matches up with the line of the rest of the door. I have found on these cars that a lot of times when guys go in and pull the Beltline weather strips out, they get real gorilla with it and they'll pry a lot on it and it'll also, so it'll take that bottom edge and actually bend it out. You want to make sure that it's flat and if nothing else, at least facing toward the inside of the door like this. If you've got a pooch like this one is here, that's kind of an issue and you don't want that on there. If that's pooching out like that, you want to take something like, I've got these two trim hammers. And you want to bend that back in. Okay, that's all right. I'll live with that. Could stand to be a little bit flatter. So I'm going to put my belt lines in. This is the belt line piece for the outside. Now it has a V to it. We got these from National Parts Depot. They make two different models of this. They have the less expensive, what I would call street grade. And then they have a restoration grade or a concours grade. These will go in and work just fine. Okay, we got that. We get these kind of set in position. You want to make sure all of these are right over the holes. Now there would be a screw that would go in right on the very end of this right here. We don't have that, so it's a little hard to get that to lay flat like we want it to. Now what it does is it lets me know where my glass needs to move to come up in the channel correctly. I'm going to put the inside one in. You also want to make sure that it's sitting where it needs to. This one needs to come down just a hair. All right, now we've got our felts in. I'll run cam back in here and we'll start adjusting this glass. Boy, that rolls up nice now though.
Now I'm gonna put the rear upper stop in. Now you're gonna take your bracket, go in through the door. You're gonna lay it on the little shelf on the glass frame itself. You're gonna roll the window up. And it should take it into position to where you can see your bolt holes just about. You might have to reach in there. Just kind of move it around. Make sure it's all the way to the back of that little shelf. You'll want to use a nut driver or a socket and extension. Just leave that one loose. You don't need to rotate the bottom out. Line up your second hole. All right, snug that, and then run the window down. Make sure it doesn't contact the glass anywhere. If you look through the glass, you can see it catch the lip and stop the window from going up any further. Now that's installed, the front one's next. All right, next up is the front window upper stop. You install it on the window frame itself. Reach through, hold it in place, and again, use a nut driver extension to go through the door. If you have small hands, you can probably just do it with your fingers. But now with the window all the way up, you're going to want to push it up until it touches the vent window frame. Go ahead and snug it down. And again, just make sure it doesn't contact anything. We are good. Now that front stop is in, we are going to adjust the front vent and the glass. Yay.
All right, now, we're gonna be talking a little bit about adjustment. I'm not gonna go through a full spate of adjustment on this particular glass, simply put because we're not keeping this stuff in here, but I am gonna show you what you need to do. Now, right now, I always go inside the car, shut the door with the glass in play all the way up at both ends, everything adjusted for height. Inside the car, I can then start going in and seeing where we're at. I also recommend that you remove the striker because the striker will allow you to open and close the door and you'll know because the glass will start to push the door out. If the striker is in play, that doesn't necessarily work because the striker is going to fool you into thinking the door's just fine and it's shutting the way it should. The door should shut and the glass not bow or move. Like right now, the front is actually in pretty good shape. But when I shut it, I know that the backpack here is loose at the bottom and tight at the top, which means the glass is actually sitting in rather than sitting square to the door itself and the quarter window. You also want to have your quarter windows in play. Now, the nice thing on this car is the quarter window and the window relationship are really good. They line up nicely. You would first go in and put this in, then align your quarter glass if it's not lined up right. Quarter glass looks good on this car. We wouldn't mess with that, in my opinion. We go in and take it out, grease it, and then just reset it. But we've got a little bit of a problem. Now, I've already gone in and made a minor adjustment on this door, but what I'm going to do now is I'm going to open the door up and show you where your adjustment points are on the glass. All right, now what this bottom one was, you have your division bar here. The division bar is actually controlled with the bottom adjustment down here. And what you do with that is you can control some of the in and out of the glass coming up and down, but it has nothing to do with the position of the glass in the all the way up. What this really mostly controls is window stutter on the way down. So the glass is rolling down. If the division bar isn't close enough up on the glass, it can cause the glass to want to chatter when it gets to the bottom of its roll down. That's why it's nice to have really good tight seals on these windows and have new moleskin or a new piece in the back, because that's just going to help control that movement coming down. If there's not moleskin on there, the glass tends to want to chatter in an up and down motion. But those two are your control points. Your main control point is this one here, the glass in and out. And one of the things I wanted to tell you about is this too. The bolt that's in here, you don't want to gorilla these things in. If you do, you can end up possibly popping that brace. This one here and this one here are basically nothing more than a tension point to keep your vent window in the correct position. If you don't have those tight, the vent window can move around and thus you'll lose all of your adjustments. But don't go too tight. If you have a lot of tension on this point here and this point here, you can end up cracking off that leg on there. So that's your front adjustments, because the window can't actually sit inside the body in a cocked fashion if you're not careful. The way to fix that is on the back. All right, now your final adjustments here are on the back side of the door, controlling the glass position this way. Our glass has been a little tight at the back. So what I did is I took the bottom bar and I moved it out a little bit. It's not going to create a huge level of adjustment. So what you may have to do is go in and mess with these two bolts up here on the top and push the bar in there over one way or the other. You don't want to go too far over, because you'll run into your belt lines and that can cause some issues with rub noises. So what you want to do is you want to make sure that you're still pretty much centered up. That's why I recommend you go in and you put the belt line weather strips in on the car when you're doing your final adjustments for glass. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to close this door off and we're going to see what we got when we shut the door. All right, moment of truth. Okay, now if I don't push on the door, I can look at the back of the glass back here and I don't have any problems with the glass pushing out like it was before. The glass is a little bit in at the bottom. I could take the top of the glass or the top of the adjustment back here and probably move things around a little bit to get that to where that lined up a little bit better. But that's real, real close. I don't know that I would be too complaining about that. We're fine up at the front, and I honestly think some of the problems with this are in the big gaping maw that we've created in the front of the door here, rather than being anything to do with the glass. The glass seems to be sitting about like it's supposed to. You'll notice that there's no push on that glass when it's hitting the weather strip much. There's a little bit up at the front. Again, we can go in and make a few adjustments inside the door to pull that out possibly a little bit more. You just have to be really careful, because you're gonna get to a point where you can overstress that brace that's in there. But this looks pretty good. I guess what we'll do now is bring Cam back in here, see what he thinks of his door that he's got to take back apart and close this bad boy out.
Man, this thing would look great if there wasn't a gigantic hole in the door.
You get to do
but
the nice thing is,
it's going to be really easy to take it back apart.
Yes, because we'll just pull it out through this side. Yeah. But we'll also go ahead and get the other door put on and put the glass in it, so we got this thing rock and roll.
This was
the other
side.
This was practice for you. See, you're becoming a body man. All right, so that's it. Basically, we've got everything in. Mm-hmm. One thing I forgot to talk about was the window stops for the crank.
Right there.
Yeah, there's one there, and then there's one on the on the bottom for the window actually rolling up, and then there's the other ones for the window down. You got to put the bumper back in. So I guess that's it then. Yeah. We've got everything done. It's all nice and greasy the way it's supposed to be. Rolls up like magic and down. It's like amazing how much difference it makes just going in and greasing everything like it's supposed to.
I thought we were going to have to replace that regulator.
What did I tell you? The lithium grease on there almost always is the culprit in making that thing not operate the way it should. And I think with our super lube.
Import approved.
We should be just fine. You're so weird. We should be just fine with that right now. So, that's our show for this week, folks. Be sure to come back and watch next time on
AutoRestomod.
Have a great week.
So,
bye.
Rock, paper, scissors for taking the door off?